Charlie Chaplin explored a new genre of entertainment and was one of the pioneers that created the motion picture industry that we know today. Chaplin's early encounters with poverty and hunger along the way to fame became a real-life rags-to-riches story that gave birth to his iconic character, the Little Tramp. Beginning in 1914, Chaplin gave his gift of acting, directing, and composing to the world in exchange for becoming one of the most celebrated historical figures still recognized today. Charlie Chaplin began exploring the career of acting in 1894 at the age of 5 in London, England. His mother, Hannah, was a struggling vaudeville performer. She was on stage singing when her voice cracked and went into a whisper. The drunken audience heckled her, laughed at her, made catcalls, and drove her off stage. As Chaplin wrote in his autobiography, "I remember the stage manager leading me by the hand and leaving me on the stage alone. I talked to the audience, danced, and in all innocence imitated mother's voice cracking and was surprised at the impact it had on the audience. There was laughter and cheers, then money throwing. That night was my first appearance on the stage and mother's last." Charlie Chaplin was in the right place at the right time. He developed his stage act through his teens and early 20s, exploring different characters and eventually impersonating a drunken audience member in a traveling vaudeville show. Chaplin's act was completely silent. This was a unique form of presentation, as most of the other players spoke or sang.
He's part of a tradition of entertainment, you know, where you're seeing the joke instead of hearing the joke, and you're commenting on it at times instead of just trying to be funny, whatever it takes.
The show traveled to New York in 1910, and Chaplin fell in love with America. He moved to Los Angeles in 1913 and was offered a film contract with Keystone Studios. Chaplin had the advantage that he was exploring this new form of entertainment during its infancy when all films were silent. His already silent act easily transferred to film.
Chaplin had the knack of being able to convey an impression, a scene, without having much language attached.
He continued exploring ways to take live theater to the movie screen, being the first to tone down his performance. He created a more subtle and less clownish form of comedy than had ever been seen on the big screen.
Charlie Chaplin was doing something extraordinary. He was simply the most sophisticated physical comedian, and he had incredibly complex ideas that he could express just with action. To this day, there haven't been very many people who are just so beautiful to watch.
So Charlie was on the assembly line, and his job, he had two wrenches, and probably an engine would come by, and he'd tighten the bolts, okay? Next engine, tighten the bolts, next engine. So when he walked out of the job, what was he doing? Just all the time, he couldn't stop tightening the bolts.
In 1919, after working with three different film studios, Charlie Chaplin, along with actors Mary Pickford, Douglas Fairbanks, and director D.W. Griffith, founded United Artists, a film company that still produces major motion pictures today, nearly 100 years later. They made this move to avoid the Hollywood studio system that was beginning to control all aspects of contracted actors' lives and monopolize the film industry. Together, the four were exploring a new business plan and structure of film studio. Each had an equal stake in the company, the freedom to make their own creative decisions, and collected the generous salaries they believed they deserved.
In a sense, he spends his whole film career exploring.
After Chaplin's mother lost her voice and job, she couldn't support herself and two children. Charlie and his older brother Sidney, at the ages of 6 and 10, were accepted into the Lambeth Workhouse, an inhumane environment with an average of 700 indigents sleeping and working in overcrowded quarters. Little Charlie and Sidney were only allowed to visit their mother every 6 months. These traumatic encounters left a deep impact on 6-year-old Charlie, which later translated into his films, such as the tragic comedy The Kid, which shows the gritty reality of poverty from a child's perspective.
The films that he made that addressed poverty made quite a strong statement about the way in which society at large views poverty or views individuals who are in economic hardship. And so it's no surprise that the zenith of his film career occurred parallel to the Great Depression in the United States.
By the 1920s, Charlie Chaplin encountered international recognition.
He made more money than any actor in history had ever made, and he got more famous than any person in history ever became.
Because of Chaplin's broad appeal that spoke to audiences of all ages, genders, and cultures, his films were exported and enjoyed all over the world. Since no actor had experienced what it was like to be a worldwide celebrity, no one was prepared for the amount of fan following and press. While most of the world was falling in love with the Tramp, Chaplin encountered many critics who questioned his personal life and morals. At the age of 29, Charlie Chaplin married his first wife, 16-year-old Mildred Harris. This marriage lasted only 2 years and was the beginning of a scandalous future for Chaplin. 4 years later, Chaplin wed 16-year-old Lita Gray, who was pregnant with his child. Their divorce in 1927 was considered one of the biggest Hollywood scandals of the time, damaging Chaplin's reputation. He was 47 when he married Paulette Goddard, a child model and actress who starred in many of Chaplin's most famous films. She was 22 when they met, but claimed to be 17. The couple split shortly after the premiere of their movie, The Great Dictator, in 1940. 1 year later, Chaplin married his fourth and final wife, 17-year-old Una O'Neill. By this time, Chaplin was in his late 50s. They ended up having 8 children together, and Una stayed with Chaplin until he died in 1977 at the age of 88. By the 1950s, the world was on edge. Ideas of communists infiltrating the United States were all over the news.
How are you going to answer the committee's questions?
The Hollywood blacklist was created, denying employment to entertainment professionals because of their suspected membership in the Communist Party.
The question is, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Charlie Chaplin was one of the hundreds on this list, which included some of the most famous figures in Hollywood.
Stand away from the stand!
Fight for the Bill of Rights, which
I
was going to
take this man away from the stand.
In 1952, Chaplin took his family on a vacation to England. The U.S. government seized this opportunity to revoke his visa, and Chaplin was exiled from America for the next 20 years. This encounter was deliberately reflected in one of Chaplin's last films, A King in New York. It is the story of the King of Estonia, who comes to America.
Surely you're not a communist.
Do I have to be a communist to read Karl Marx?
The U.S. House of Un-American Activities Committee deems the king a communist and throws the family of a boy he has befriended into jail. The film was banned in the United States until 1972, 15 years after its release in England.
In the name of democracy, let us use that power! Let us all unite!
Charlie Chaplin was born with the talents of acting, directing, composing, and storytelling. He not only gave the world the gift of laughter, but also wove social commentary into his films through the combination of comedy and tragedy. In exchange, the world gave Chaplin a devoted audience who greatly respected his work and made him one of the most famous entertainers in history.
Somehow seem to be speaking to us now, even though the work they did was not now. It stands the test of time.
$0.15, please.
In 1940, the Tramp spoke for the first time in a message to the world about war, dictatorship, and humanity.
Dictators free themselves, but they enslave the people!
Chaplin's movie The Great Dictator was his most political film and very risky to create since World War II was just beginning.
The most popular man in the world meets the most terrifying, scary man in the world in the form of this movie.
The Great Dictator is a very obvious parody of Hitler, Nazi Germany, and fascism.
Hey, the Strafkitz Hilfensekt! The Wiener Schnitzel mit der Lagerbeeren und der Sauerkraut! Hey, the Flüten sagt der Flüten!
They still make people laugh. We're not just watching them as a historical curiosity. We're watching them because they're entertaining.
Despite his challenging childhood, Charlie Chaplin had rare talent and became one of the earliest innovators who explored the dawn of the art and business of film. Chaplin encountered many hardships in his early life, was criticized for his personal life, and was targeted as a communist in his later career. He was the first celebrity to be idolized internationally. Chaplin shared his gift of making people laugh through social commentary, and in exchange, the world became his adoring audience, who brought the poor little tramp into the limelight and allowed him to live the American dream of success and prosperity.
The inscription reads to Charles Chaplin for the incalculable effect he has had in making motion pictures the art form of this century. Chaplin has become more than a name. It is a word in the vocabulary of films. A tramp, a gentleman, a poet, a dreamer, a lonely fellow, always hopeful of romance and adventure. Chaplin made more people laugh than anyone in history, yet always. Just beneath the hilarity were the fears and sorrows of every man.